Hello everyone, so lovely to see so many people here today from many different places, amazing. I hope that we can add to your quarantine today.
Okay, so hello everyone. I think we have almost 160 participants right now. I hope everyone is safe and sound. Welcome to Mind Leaders Live. A quick introduction would be Mind Leaders Live is a series of webinars brought to you by Mind Global. And every Saturday, we are going to have a global design leader from across the globe come over and talk about their experiences, talk about their journey and the importance of design and design strategy in their life, in their projects, and especially times like these. Mind Global, a quick intro to Mind Global. It's an initiative by Manipal Global and Spread. I hope all of us in India already know of Manipal. It's a more than 50-year-old university, and Spread happens to be a global design strategy and innovation firm with its centers in Bangalore in India and Brussels in Belgium. And we launched on Sunday, May 2nd. I would like to thank each and every one of you for the overwhelming response we have had since then. We have 3,000 plus hits, 500 plus registrations. We are almost touching 200 live participants right now. And I want to thank each and every one for you for taking time to check out the website, for taking time to register, and especially for being here right now. Okay, with this, I would quickly want to play an introductory video from Sonia, founder and partner of Spread Design and Strategy, Design Strategy and Innovation, who is also the organization that brings you this particular webinar.
A collective creative mind is what we need most in the present global scenario to be able to create a better, more hopeful future. Mind Leaders Live are conversations where we connect the dots along with folks who have deep experience in design and innovation. It's where our minds meet. Join us now.
Now I'll quickly move back to introducing our speaker for the day, who happens to be Cansu Ozgul. She is Turkish by origin. She runs Contemco, which is a contemporary innovation company. It's a design strategy and marketing firm based out of New York, focuses on experience, data tech, and future of things. They have clients like huge clients like Marriott Hotels, Brookfield, Bodum, and many other startups. Cansu, in her past, has worked as an accounts manager with Imaginity, which is majorly a branding and packaging industry with integrated marketing, markets in US, Europe, and Asia. They have clients like Pepsi, Nestle, Codex, and Kimberly Clark. She also has a history of working in media and digital advertising. She has worked with a leading firm called Fantasy Interactive, with clients like Google, Microsoft, Coca-Cola, Disney, NBC, Porsche, Ducati, AOL, and I can like go forever, but I'll stop here. She has also worked with Johnson Art Studio and Mosaic Fashion. In her career. Since 2012, she's a part of Dreamian, which is an innovation network for visionaries, creative leaders, innovators, entrepreneurs, and activists. She is also the co-owner of Mitra Textile Consultancy and Trade since 2008. Reflecting on her academic background, she has a BBA and strategic design and management from Parsons Schools of Design. Parsons, if you haven't heard of it, it's one of the largest and most famous design schools across the globe. She also has interest in music and has learned piano and theory of music at London Royal College of Music. And earlier today, she was at Parsons talking about being a speaker at one of the panels today at Parsons School of Design. She's also an active mentor there. So with this, I would hand it over to Cansu to lead the conversation from here on. Before I do that, I'll quickly tell the audience that you can hear us, but we probably cannot hear you. So if you have anything that you want to tell us, please use the chat box. If you have questions, use the Q&A segment and not the chat box because we'll lose that. Over to you, Cansu.
Thank you so much for the lovely introduction and for doing this for me because I hate talking about myself, but it's so lovely to connect with all of you today, especially now that we're all going through some strange times. It's extremely exciting for me to see such an interesting program that Mind is planning for you guys. And since my background is strategic design and management, I was extremely excited to see to be part of this platform. And I'm honored to be the first speaker for the organization today. So I'm gonna try to share my screen with you guys. And let me know if you can actually see it. I know it's been quite some unsettling time, so actually I would like to start with a short breathing session. So please take a comfortable position and just close your eyes and turn your attention inward. Sitting up tall with straight spine, take a full inhale with your nose, and as you breathe out from your nose, lengthen your exhale. On your next breath, count the length of your exhale. And now use this number as your guide and make your inhale as half as your exhale. The intention is to keep your exhale long. So I'll let you sit in silence just for a moment with this. Okay, so welcome back. I know you guys are here today imagining something different. You probably weren't expecting me to start with a breathing. I promise we will be back on design after this point, but I feel like it's been such stressful times for most of us, and I guess we're truly grateful that we are here today. If we are here, it means that we are healthy. So I think we should all be thankful. And you know, I think you guys were imagining something different for me to start with, but it brings us to our subject matter, design, which is a tool to think differently, act differently, and see differently. And, you know, as a creative or as a designer, you're always expected to bring something different to table and surprise others, or at least do something unexpected, but also meaningful. Anyway, I would like to kick off by defining design. I know we have some design professionals with us today. However, for those who are new to the subject, I would like to start with the description of design as part of our dictionary today. Design matters profoundly to us in many ways and represents an area of huge underutilized potential in life. As you know, we are all connected than we actually know. Whether it's business or any other thing, design helps us appreciate and understand the complex connections between people, places, objects, events, and ideas. All the super normal things we see around the world, this is the most powerful driver of innovation. It's what guides long-range strategic planning. It's what shapes business decisions that have to be based on future opportunities rather than past events. It is what sparks the imagination and what reveals the truth. So if we were to look at the role of design, I love this book, and feel free to note the book name here. John Haskin actually transforms the way we think about design by showing how integral it is to our daily lives, from the spoon we use to eat our breakfast cereal and the car we drive to work, to even medical equipment used to save lives. Like today, for instance, those respiratory products play a crucial role during the COVID. And again, that's all about design, right? So, and how it's done is basically design focuses on the end user, leverages collective expertise, employs empathy, and creates value while solving real problems. And, you know, we used to live in a world of just objects and things, but today we are living in a world of flows and negotiations. And I feel like now is the time to advance businesses that will have a positive impact on our world. Brands that understand and respectfully navigate the situation will be rewarded as we emerge from these unusual circumstances. This is where we see design at its best, by solving problems and pairing well-considered solutions with a market that is in need of them. And you know, that's the beauty of design. It's about the future. You may have no solid proof about your idea, but your imagination, supported by your argument, is what really matters. And, you know, nothing in life is constant, just like how we see today. Everything is changing. And our role as designers or creators or creatives is to adapt to developments and manage crises and use our tools to engage in life in a productive way. So you see, designers' role actually shifts from creating beautiful things, then empathizing with the client or the situations and finding alternative solutions and making sure the designs are engaging and result-oriented. And now with COVID and all the situation, all brands, whether startup or international, are experiencing the same challenges and constraints. And for designers, thinkers, creators, makers, doers, solvers, networkers, business people and artists, I don't think there is any better time than now to leverage our alternative thinking and problem solving capacities. And, you know, again, with life as we know it stood at a halt, our imagination and creative thinking has been put to test. And, you know, I feel like we would never have pressed the pause ourselves if this never happened. So it's, I think, important to just step back and question these things.
So, yeah, I think that's a great start, Cansu. Thanks. For an amazing intro on design. I think what we are looking forward to, you have definitely have a interesting journey and moved from one place to another, and then also moved from one culture to another over and over. So what I would want to do is to help get an understanding. For example, even I have moved from culture to another. I'm basically from Dhanbad, which is Jharkhand, and it's quite a remote place. And then I moved to Delhi and Bangalore and work with colleagues who are primarily German and then from US. So being a part of roughly five cultures.
Okay, so I think I guess the answer would be a long one. So I'm going to try to make it a short one, which is more difficult. But I feel like if we were to relate it to design, especially, I would say that to start with my own nationality, Turkey, I think you see a lot of effects of culture on education. And, you know, our education system here was very much based on memory, which is basically meaning you are given an information and you just have to memorize it and take it as it is. Whereas design is really all about asking questions and finding alternative solutions. But when a system tells you this is what you need to believe in and you need to accept it, to acknowledge it as given, then you're left with no creativity. So I think one of the ways that I felt more free when I went to USA was that I was free to think, I was free to ask questions. And you know, in the beginning, I was really shy to ask questions. And for instance, when I went to university at Parsons, the teachers would really appreciate when you asked a question. I was super surprised that they were very like, appreciative of it. And so I think one of the things culturally different is definitely like how you're brought up to think, and then you know, I think we need to also see it as from two different sides. One is communicating an idea, and then one is perceiving an idea. So the way there's a way you communicate something to a culture, and it might be the same thing. It might be, let's say, a lip balm, but the way you communicate it to one culture has to be a little different than another. If it's a more conservative culture, you have to be maybe communicating it in a more conservative way. Whereas if it's a more open-minded culture, it can be more of a, you can add a little bit more spice to it, a little more sexiness to it. So it really affects a lot of different aspects of it. And another thing is, I feel like, you know, looking back at my journey, the way design changed all around the world, I think, it's quite been a journey. Like if you look at 10 years ago, when I first started my company it wasn't even a company, it was more like an open innovation organization where we used to pick one theme, and I would invite people from different expertises, like an architect, a knowledge broker, a finance person, etc. And we used to work around that same subject matter and create projects around it, which then transitioned into becoming a consultancy using different expertises. But when I first started, I remember my parents couldn't really explain their friends when they asked them, what is your daughter doing in the US? They used to say, tell them, like, ask her, because we can't really explain you. So I think I had a lot of challenging times explaining what design is and what I was trying to do. And same thing for, like, when you go to clients, you're performing something for them, but then if they don't understand what you're doing, if they don't know the value of what you're doing, you cannot really convince them. You won't feel satisfied with the project, and you will not even be able to charge them for something. And so there was a lot of challenges when I first started. But now, you know, now design is more about engagement and digital and creating experiences, which I'm going to be talking about and showing examples of in a second. But yeah, again, it's a big subject, but definitely a very interesting question. Thank you.
So I just wanted to, like, pick up on what you mentioned of how education system is shaped. So I think it's very similar in India. And the education system that we have today, the one that we have today was left back by the British after they were leaving the country after 200 years of colonization. And it was left back with an intention to make the entire economy utilitarian to the industrial revolution going on in Europe back then. So it was not designed to create thinkers or leaders or foster creativity. It was designed on the foundations of conformity, compliance, and obedience to create people who could work in factories. So it definitely does not at all allow or welcome questions or being questioned. And since everything else is built on top of the education system, I think all the other system kind of inherit that.
Yeah.
So I can totally relate to that, because I've always been someone with a lot of questions, and I've had the hard time throughout the education system and still today.
Yeah.
Sorry, you were saying something?
No, I also just remembered another example. For instance, you know, you mentioned I used to work with Imaginity, which is a packaging, it's an international packaging company for most of the worldly known FMCG companies. And we used to do a lot of bottle designs for, like, for spritz or beer brands. And so when I came to Turkey, I reached out to one of the beer brands that was really cool. And then I realized that this country doesn't let you do marketing for these products, for instance. Then it really pushes you to be extra creative and find ways around it to kind of communicate that brand through different stories or activations.
Yeah, that's pretty much what my experience has also been. So I think it basically started when I joined a German firm where I was working as a tech in a tech profile, and it was basically about asking a lot of questions, and that's where I got introduced to design thinking and fell in love with the process, and I moved from tech towards design, and, like, since the last 3 years I've been working in design. So yeah, interesting journey, and I can totally relate to especially where you bring in how design is the new revolution in the education system, because it demands asking questions, it demands asking the right questions, it demands looking for the right problems. And definitely, as we can see design growing in the last 2 to 3 years in India, especially with so many design schools and organizations coming up and so many design studios coming up, it's definitely growing. And it's slowly what happened to management around 10, 15 years back is now happening to design now. And design is the new management is the word in the industry. So definitely picking up.
I actually just remembered one more really funny story. You know, I always wanted to be a car designer. I was very much into cars. And when I was studying at Parsons in New York, I was looking for jobs at a car company. And then when I was Googling jobs, I found this company, digital agency called Fantasy. I think someone in the chatbot recognized them because they're one of the biggest digital agencies in the world. They work with Google, Apple, etc. Anyway, I saw their work on digital. They were working with some car companies like Ferrari, Land Rover, etc. And so I applied for a job there, and the first day I went for a job interview, I remember I was shocked by their work culture, because you know, in New York you expect to go into an office that's like a high-rise building and super serious, etc. But it was actually located in Tribeca. It was almost like a home. I had to like ring the bell and then someone opened, and the first thing I saw was that person was without the shoes. So I was like, what's going on here? I was so shy. Like the way I dressed up was like not really, I wasn't prepared to take off my shoes. They asked me to take off my shoes. And you know, this is like my first day going there as an interviewer. So then they told me the company culture was, they tried creating almost like a home, like an environment so that the creatives could work super comfortably inside the company. And there were like, there were ping pong tables. People used to like, you know, take their laptops and go and lie down somewhere and work like that. So it was like super strange to me in the beginning. But again, talking about culture and how it's related to creativity, or how we even, the way we work, it really affects our creativity.
I think, yes, it's, I think one of the, I think key ingredients of design strategy or design thinking would be the space. And I think one of, I think in Bangalore, I think we have Design Barn, which is one of the, probably the only open innovation space, which has hosted many design events called Design Open. Mm-hmm. And yes, I totally agree to you that the space and the vibe around you definitely takes, has an effect on the way you think and the way you look at things. And whoever is in Bangalore in the audience, I would, I welcome you to Barn. Just search Design Barn, and if you think that space, you would like to explore innovation space, it's definitely one of the things that you can go and visit. You can just reach out to someone and they can plan an industry visit, and then you can take a look at it. It's very much like a place which is like an ecosystem in itself. Meanwhile, I would love to, Cansu, move to our next segment, where you can maybe talk about a couple of success stories or case studies, which might be interesting to our audience. Most of our audience is our young people who are either graduating or have graduated very recently. So if you can come up with something that can be valuable to them, that probably they can draw inspiration from, that would be great.
Yeah, okay. Sure. I mean, we are here to share our experiences as, you know, and try to help as much as we can. So actually, it's an interesting question. Again, I was on a panel with Parsons yesterday with the graduating class, and we were actually all talking about this, about jobs and what are the most important, what are the like most interesting questions that we came across with when we applied to jobs and stuff like that. And one of the things, you know, one of the things that came up was that today when you apply for a job, especially in design and creativity, I feel like even myself, like when someone applies for a job at our company, I look at their Instagram to see their vision or who they're following on their Instagram and stuff like that. So I can see where they're coming from, how they're thinking, what their vision is, who they see as a role or as an example, and so on. Because you know, when you work with someone, it's not just about a diploma, but it's also about, like, you know, at the end of the day, you spend a lot of time with that person, and you become a team, and you want to work with like-minded people to create that vision. So I think that's also one important thing. I feel like we also need to take advantage of the technology and be able to use that instead of, you know, you can actually save your time and employers' time by creating digital, just your website, and just tell them to click on that link and go see your work. And even that will show them, oh, wow, okay, this person went a step ahead and, you know, and so organized that, like, put together their own website, and I can see everything here and stuff like that. So, you know, try to see it from an employer's point of view. If you were to hire someone, what would you look for? You would want someone you can trust, you can work with all day. And, you know, those are important things. And imagine you're super busy. You wanna remember that these people are usually very busy people, so you need to make it easy for them as well. I hope I was able to answer your question.
I totally agree with you on the part that somehow self-branding is not a huge part of our education system. And a lot of us kind of lack there. And that's also what I do as a brand strategist, work in the brand space. And that's why, as a part of the PGCP program that we have, is one of the things that we have is Mindship, which is basically helping you build your own portfolio, irrespective of what you have done, build your own portfolio, put your all your work together in one place, because we are so much more than our designation and the moment as humans. And I think having a portfolio helps us portray that, but because when we are hiring, we are not just hiring a set of skill sets, we are hiring a person with a lot of non-cognitive and tangible attributes, which also come handy while in the job. So yes,
and also, like, I would get out of just traditional beliefs and, you know, try to build a relationship with them, not just apply through with a click, but also, like, try to build a relationship with them and try to show them that you're really willing to do anything for that job, and that you're really, really enthusiastic about it, because that's very valuable for an employer, because it's not very easy to find people that will, because it's a rocky road. Everything looks amazing from outside, but inside the company, there will be days that are difficult. There will be days that both sides will have to support each other. So that relationship is also very important, and you need to create, you need to give that feeling to that side from the beginning.
Yeah, totally. Totally agree to that. And I think we should move to our next segment, where we talk about creativity insights on how our creatives, and when I say creatives, I mean both individuals and organizations, thinking about the way forward in the current situation that we have right now. So something that I can bring in is that we have a lot of organizations who have realized that a lot of people right now are working from home and with the same productivity, and at times, in some cases, more. So a lot of organizations are actually looking at having a certain percentage of their employees working from home permanently in the future, which will definitely change the way things work. And it's also a huge, huge cut in the cost for the organizations. So a lot of such ideas coming out from this situation that we are in, which will change the future of work and the way we interact and the way we kind of work with each other. So over to you on what insights that you have come across.
I think I would like to start talking about what we are expecting from the future. And I think I can show a couple case studies for you guys, if that's okay with you. So I would like to share again, like, what we see in the future consumer, because as I mentioned, it's all about the end user when it comes to design. And, you know, we see that as low impact consumerism becoming mainstream and interest in sustainable processes and products rise, attention will shift to reducing the amount of new raw materials being introduced into supply chain. And the circular economy has been valued as a $1 trillion opportunity right now. And brands that start planning and researching and innovating now will gain a market's edge with a new breed of consumer more likely to challenge how a purchase impacts the planet. So, and that being said, we see that with future consumer, we're seeing an adaptation to more conscious consumer. We see that brands will take a lead in design-led solutions. And we also see that consumers having climate change anxiety, even with this COVID, there's a lot of uncertainty around, and we already see a lot of anxiety around. But we want to say future is bright than it looks. And I want to show a couple examples by categories. One of them is that designing emotion humans will be demanding more from technology and from themselves. And emotional intelligence and connections, both real and digital, will be cornerstones of the future. Increasingly, we will integrate human needs for touch and physicality in a world of invisible tech. And at the same time, this will give tech a sense of emotion. So in short, as humans become more digital, we will need to make technology become more human as well, or humans will need more emotional experiences. So one of the things at my agency that we really like to focus on is to build experiences. One of my favorite quotes is Maya Angelou's quote, which is that people really forget what you tell them or what you do for them, but they never forget how you make them feel. So when we create something, we always try to create feelings, sell feelings, because creating a relationship with the end user is very important in design. To give you one of the examples is that one of our clients were Edition Hotels, which is a unique concept in the lifestyle hotel space conceived by Ian Schrager and Marriott International. And I was responsible. I was the director of culture and entertainment, as well as we were leading their creatives and social media last year. And one of the things that again, I was responsible of was creating experiences and connect those design pieces that I was working on into events and the ways to interact with people. So what I did was I brought some partnerships to table so that we could create events, and basically that would drive sales to the brand. And one thing that we did was doing a partnership with Inscape meditation app, which is a spacious center offering group guided meditation sessions in a modern atmosphere in New York. And I knew the team from New York, and I asked the voice of the meditation, Bianca, who's actually Australian. I invited her to Turkey, and we created some experiential things. So for instance, you see, you need to tie your designs with a human interaction. So you simply need to make your design alive by adding a human experience to it. So it's not just about creating designs for your clients today. And you know, you will be come across with a lot of like campaigns and flyers and so on. But if you leave them there, it's not gonna work. You always need to think about it online to offline, offline to online. So what we always try to do is, we're not just designing something just out of like to design, but we always try to tie it with a human experience. So one of them was like this meditation session. And another point that I need to make is you also need to look at human behavior and what customers of your brand is expecting. For instance, wellness, mindfulness, these are the things that are at stake right now. A lot of people are looking for this kind of experiences. So I brought this woman and we created a meditation night by the beach of the hotel, which brought a lot of PR in the end. At the end, everyone, all the guests were super happy and they wanted more. And it also inspired brand to go for more of this kind of partnerships. And let me share this with you. So it's a little fun piece for us.
Thank you.
I just wanted to show you that we were creating this kind of experiences. And in the end of this event, for instance, we saw that on social media, their followers, and within the first month, it came from 19.2 to around like 21.3K. And it was a big, big rise. And also, like, you can see their profile visits came from 8,000 to 27,000 in a month. Again, it was a big success. Whereas today, like, for instance, moving forward with the next season, this is just, you know, 2 months ago, as you all know, suddenly there's this COVID and the hotel was ready to, you know, launch another successful season. And, you know, suddenly you have this situation and you don't know when you can even open your hotel. What do you do? Everyone is expecting you to communicate with them. Everyone is asking, when are you planning to open? Are you going to be able to open? What's your plan? But you don't know. So what do you do in this situation is you need to still stick to your brand identity and do whatever you do, aligning with your brand positioning and your tone of voice and all that. So we had to sit down with the whole marketing group and create a communication to basically like keep the relations going with our community. So our role as an agency was to guide them about how to communicate with the community that's expecting you to give them an answer without having the answer, because you don't have an answer. But we see that being honest with them and really just letting them know that you are there, that you're doing everything you can, you're doing your research and you're trying your best to open, is what you can only do. So crisis management is also extremely important in a way, and we saw that a lot here. Speaking of that, I think we need to also talk about design sense. And, you know, when we talk about design sense, it's about adapting to circumstances and sensitizing to shifts. I don't want to talk about like negative things, so I'm going to try to jump into a little bit more positive, let's say, shifts. So, you know, according to shifts, we need to make design our natural, you know, you need to make design your natural adaptive sense to survive. Adapt and thrive, basically. And for instance, let's look at these new customer trends. We see that online shopping will be more important than ever. A race for BOPIS. BOPIS means buy online, pick up in the store. Intensely personal customer care. New technologies move quickly to mainstream and opportunities to serve your customers in new ways, for instance. So these are like new customer trends. And how do you adapt to them? Which I'm going to show you with one of our current clients right now. So just before that, just to give another background information, I took a screenshot of CNBC's article last week, which is talking about after COVID, how are the fashion brands are going to act in their stores. For instance, Zara is now thinking about removing their fitting rooms. So as a designer, how do you imagine a store or a shopping experience with new normal after COVID? And you know, as an agency also, it's our role to guide our customers to take the right actions towards the new normal today. So let me present you this client of us, which is based on personalized shopping experience. It's a 3D AI powered apparel shopping match platform. It's basically, which I will show you a video soon, but it's a 3D AI platform where you go to their little pop-ups, you get scanned, and then afterwards, when you go online shopping, you see everything that's your fit matches. So when you go to shopping online, you know that and everything that you see is basically picked for you based on your body measurements. So you are fit risk-free, there's no more returns, you don't need to deal with returns, etc. And now, given that post-COVID there won't be any fitting rooms, you need to know your measurements and you want to know that it will fit you, and you don't want to go to a store and wear people's like those clothes on, because you don't know who wore before you. So shifting into a more hygiene focused market, how, like, as a designer, you need to think about new technologies, new ways, new experiences to offer your customers who are more aware, like who are a bit anxious about it. So let me show you their video here. Experiences shifting, and they're trying to use 3D in order to eliminate the fitting rooms and wearing the touching those clothes. And again, like we see an innovation here already with the mindset shift, and we try to create new solutions. This was their first pop-up that I helped designing the concept with. We were given a very, very small budget, and it was the first pop-up. We didn't know if the concept was going to work. This was before COVID. This was in November when we first started the project. And, a lot of people loved it. And what I considered before designing this space was, one, you know that people love Instagram and they loved your like Instagram corners. There's a concept called Ice Cream Museum in USA. You might be familiar with it. And people love the experience there. So we knew that we needed to give these people an Instagrammable thing so that it's fun for them and create curiosity from outside so they go in and they want to test the product. And then, this was our first case study project with the client, and I helped them with the interior design, their marketings, the video that you just watched, etc. And then we're working on the online shopping experience. And as you can see, they were on Business Insider, WWD, Houston. It was in Houston, so that we were seen in the local press there as well. But yeah, I think that's an important example. Another thing is, I feel like I wanna give one more example about shifting trends, which is a little more fun. Forget about COVID, forget about the bad scenarios or what's happening. Also see like how people are more conscious about what they put into their bodies, how they're eating, their habits are changing, the way they, their nutrition is changing, and a lot of people are going for a vegan diet.
Cansu.
So we see that, you know, even those old brands have to change their mindset at some point. And that was the last example I wanted to give. So over to you. I'm gonna stop sharing my screen now. Yeah.
And it would also be great if you can just click on the Q&A icon and look at a few of the questions that you would probably that are directed at you. I can see a question that I can answer. What is Design Barn and what is the space that I spoke about? So Design Barn is a space, is an innovation space in Bangalore. You can just go and Google search it on Google Maps, a Design Barn, B-A-R-N. And it is, I think, probably the only open innovation space in Bangalore. There are other innovation spaces by corporates and organizations, but they are closed and they are only for the specific organization. A question on the Design Barn visit, I think the Design Barn, you can just reach out to someone through the email and plan an industry visit. All you have to do is go to the website and request a visit. It could be a group, better if it's a group, and also it could be a individual coming in for one of our events. So there are a lot of events that we have done in the past, majorly Design Open. There are a few more Design Open Happy that is coming up in the next few days. Please follow Spread and Design Barn on Instagram. we post all our upcoming events there. And there's also some question on design strategy and innovation, probably regarded to career. I think I would quickly like to tell you a little about the PGCP program that is being launched by Mind Global. So a few USPs that I can definitely share with you right away would be that, first of all, it's designed for working professionals and people who are graduating. So it's definitely tailor-made for you. And the curriculum, the major key USPs are that the curriculum is designed by industry leaders. So it's very much up to date with what's happening out there in the industry. And the delivery is also by people who are out there in the industry. We have industry experts who will be delivering these sessions. And while you work on this, usually when you work in an academic project, you come on to a course, you learn something, and then you appear for an examination where you memorize stuff and probably write it out there in the examination. What we have here is something called as DARE, which is a life project from an organization or proposed by a design leader, a reputed design leader in the design world. And the day you come in, you start working on the project. So this gets, I mean, this is as close as it gets to the, I would say, real world or how things happen in the industry. Also, because this is for industrial, I mean, professionals, and also it is for people who have graduated immediately. So we definitely need to keep enough space for you to keep working. So there's a work, there's a weekend model where you can attend the classes online on the weekend. And also right now, owing to the situation, there's a huge discount running. Please go on to mindglobal.com and you can visit the site, read about all the details of the program. And it's a 6-month long program where you get certified and also get to work with a lot of industry professionals. Something that you gain from this program that is not a part of regular programs would be a huge network that you build, that you get access to, and that you build while you are in the program of industry experts. So, and then you also, everyone who signs up in the program also becomes a part of the Design Bond community and Design Open community. So you get to be a part of Design Open, which is basically, again, a platform to inspire design conversations. We have had three major events in the past, with one in collaboration with Kochi Design Week, one in collaboration with the WDO General Assembly that happened in Hyderabad Design Week, and the other one with Microsoft. So I would invite you to take a look at Design Open.
I'm looking at questions and Q&A section. We already talk about the portfolio and the design bar, and then how do you see retail design change post pandemic? Yeah, it's a great question. So I think, as I was mentioning, a lot of people are looking for more hygiene, definitely contactless experiences, including payment systems. We're expecting to see that there needs to be faster checkouts, maybe just digital payments. And then with fashion, as I was explaining, a lot of brands are considering removing their fitting rooms just for, you know, just out of, again, hygiene reasons. So definitely a lot of retail design change. Also, I was reading an article yesterday about New York, and they were like in meatpacking area, they were considering, just like how restaurants have an outdoor space, they were also thinking of, since summer is coming, they were also thinking of giving these retail spaces a little bit more outside spaces. So it can be a little bit safer for people. But I don't know how winter would be. So it's us designers' role to imagine a future considering all these challenges today. And then how can you decide on the... I think that was for you. Is design thinking overrated? It's like every second company talking about it without much understanding. What is your take on it? Yeah, it's a funny and a good question, actually. You know, I never mention design thinking to a brand almost, because they usually don't know what I'm talking about. Again, like one of my challenges, even when I started, was like to explain people what design really is. I think instead of using design thinking word, I always try to communicate it as finding alternative solutions. I just say, let's look at it. Let's deconstruct everything and see where the problem is and try to reconstruct afterwards. So this is just how I try to explain them. But you're right, like design thinking can be a little bit annoying after a while sometimes.
I think there's one specific question for you that says, do you think the technologies will create a high unemployment rate because there will be a lot of automation and people will lose their jobs?
Yes.
Or do you think the trends of jobs will also change?
So interesting enough, definitely. I mean, it is true that, let's say, we are stuck at home right now. But let's say, like, you can still have your factory keep where you can. If your factory was based on robots, it could stay open and it could continue to produce, which is amazing for one side, right? But at the same time, it does leave some other people jobless. But then at the same time, we will need to be teaching robots how to. And then the other expectation is that once we go to that side of things, when everything is a little bit more and more digital, we will need to humanize technology. And that's when robots will need us again. Or people, like even with schools, they're expecting classes like emotions, human interactions, etc. So I think, yes, in a way, there will be a decline in workforce in some areas, but then there will be other jobs to born out of this. But I think it's very interesting to think about, and I can see why we should be worried also.
Definitely technology puts people out of job, but I think technology also creates a lot of jobs as it kind of depletes a lot of them. So there are a lot of jobs today, like digital marketer, community managers. These jobs didn't exist 10 years back, but we have them now. So yes.
I saw that someone is actually heading to Parsons for strategic design management program, which is amazing. Congratulations. And the question that came from there was, move from space of architecture and construction into user research and design strategy. What can I do to prepare for making this switch seamless? Yeah, definitely. I actually had a book suggestion in the end of my presentation, which I couldn't show you guys, but I would highly recommend reading this book called Design-Driven Innovation by Roberto Verganti. I can just type it on the chat here. Design-Driven Innovation by Roberto Verganti. I think this is a really interesting book. And if you can email me, I can also suggest other books. I think it will also be interesting to read other design companies' case studies. Like I love IDEO, for instance, one of my favorite design companies. You can see how they use design.
So there's an interesting question on someone who's trying to make a career shift. Harshal, 7+ years in advertising and copywriter, now trying to move to fashion styling. So yes, I think it's something that we all do at some point of time, Harshal. And even I have a pure tech background. I'm tech from Bits Pilani, used to work as a techie and for 4 years. And now today I am the program director for Mind Global, which is, again, it's basically designed to deliver design strategy and innovation as a program. So I totally understand the shift that you are making. And the program is also designed for people who are making this shift, to help them to reach a certain point. So if you think you will want to reach out to someone from the Mind Global team, I think that would be great for you to, you'll have someone to discuss this with. Yeah. So Cansu, do you have more questions that you'll like to take? Because we are running out of time, and I'll recommend that everyone can maybe take our emails. I think Cansu's email is already there. There is a Mind email that is also put in the chat. So if you can take up our emails and write to us with your questions, that would be great. I think we are already 15 minutes past the 4 o'clock mark where we were supposed to close. So I'll quickly try to play a closing video of our managing director in Brussels.
Hi there. Mind Leaders Live will be our journey together to make design, innovation, creativity, and entrepreneurship the powerful force we need for a bright new future. Join us for the conversations as we discover connections, reconstruct futures, and remind ourselves of how powerful we can all be together. See you on Mind. Cheers.
In case you have questions for Alok, what you can do is you can reach out to him on LinkedIn or also on Instagram to post your questions. And then once he is available, he'll probably come back and answer. So I think with that, we come to a closing of the session. I think I have already shared a lot about Design Barn. What we will do for all our people who are attending the session, we'll drop a follow-up email where we give you an idea of what Design Barn is in the video. You will also be invited to a Facebook group. All of you who have attended the session today would automatically be a part of our community from here on. You would be invited to a Facebook group. If you wish to join, please do. Everyone also gets a badge. And I would request all of you to drop in at Design Barn and collect your physical badges, which we have ready for you whenever you feel like. Probably the most ideal time would be to join us at one of our upcoming events once the lockdown is over. And thank you. In case you have any questions, I will request you to kindly use the email IDs, and I'll request you to kindly use the contact information on Mind Global School, Mind Global site to reach out to us. Okay, with this, I'll probably say bye-bye to everyone.
Thank you, everyone.
If you have some closing notes, please feel free to share.
Yeah, so I shared my email with you guys. Feel free to reach out. And I'm wishing everyone health and good luck.
Okay, thanks a lot, everyone, for joining. See you soon on the next event, which is next Saturday. You'll get a link to the next event in the follow-up email. Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye. Have a nice day.
Thank you.
See you next Saturday. Bye-bye.